He was everything this business should be. The energy, the entertainment. He was exactly what a professional wrestler should be.
One of the most intense and most outspoken superstars ever in the WWE.
When I first saw The Ultimate Warrior back in the 80s, I said, oh man, this is a game changer, and he definitely was a game changer.
And if what that man did in his life makes the blood pulse through the body of others, then his essence will be immortalized. And the spirit of Ultimate Warrior will run forever!
The Ultimate Warrior, one of the most dynamic individuals in professional wrestling and a superstar whose rise to the top was only matched by how quickly he seemed to fade from sight. Born Jim Hellwig, he would embrace the Ultimate Warrior completely, having his name legally changed to The Warrior. The Warrior had a tumultuous relationship with the WWE, abandoning the company not once but twice, later leading to the WWE commissioning a home video just to bury him. Nevertheless, the Warrior's story is a reminder that there are no burnt bridges in the WWE, as he seemingly made up with them, entering its Hall of Fame in 2014 and giving a poignant message to his fans the Raw after WrestleMania 30. However, his heartfelt return was tainted by tragedy when he died the next day, leaving fans and wrestlers both to wonder if he and or the WWE knew his days were limited, hence his unexpected reconciliation with his longtime foe Vince McMahon. Also, was there a financial motivation for his return, and an even more personal one as his marriage may have been on the rocks? Join us now as Wrestlelamia looks at the final days of the Ultimate Warrior. The Ultimate Warrior's success happened like a nuclear chain reaction, as it seemed to grow exponentially with more and more fans embracing one of wrestling's most incredible personalities. Perhaps jumping the gun, Vince McMahon put the WWF Championship on the Warrior at WrestleMania 6, hoping to turn Warrior into his top star and for Hulk Hogan to become a Babe Ruth of wrestling, assuming an important but secondary role to the Warrior. However, when the Warrior's world title reign didn't live up to McMahon's hopes, he put the belt back on Hogan. The Warrior was still a top figure, but it was clear he wasn't cut out for the role of a world champion. By the summer of 1991, the Warrior was upset with his payouts and demanded McMahon remedy the problem, or he wouldn't show up for SummerSlam's main event as scheduled. McMahon claims he felt he had no choice but to acquiesce, and he paid the Warrior, only to promptly suspend him. The Warrior left the WWF, but when business softened, McMahon wooed him back in. The Warrior had cultivated a new look, leading to the infamous urban legend that the original Warrior had died and been replaced by an imposter. This return was shortened by the federal government's crackdown on both steroids and Vince McMahon, leading to the WWE showing Warrior the door. The Warrior disappeared from wrestling with the exceptions of a handful of matches on the independent circuit. However, as the business began to slide, Vince McMahon brought the Warrior back in 1996, this time with the Warrior making a handful of appearances until another dispute led to his exit. A Warrior would claim that he needed time off to mourn the loss of his recently departed father, while Vince McMahon would claim the Warrior had no-showed live events and was never close to his father. The Warrior's popularity in fans' minds was seen when WCW brought in the wrestler Rick Wilson in 1995. Wilson played the Renegade, a ridiculous rip-off of the Ultimate Warrior that WCW thought might fool the fans. However, when the Ultimate Warrior called out Wilson for impersonating him, WCW dropped the idea that Wilson was the Warrior. Still, it showed how in demand the Warrior was by the fans, something that would lead to the real Warrior appearing in WCW. In 1998, the Warrior appeared in WCW, with many fans claiming Hulk Hogan brought him in to avenge his loss at WrestleMania 6. The return was a disaster, as the Warrior's lengthy promos and incredulous storylines were only topped in terribleness by his legendary awful match against Hogan at Halloween Havoc.
It's a lighter! Hollywood Hogan!
The Warrior disappeared from wrestling again. His activities outside of the ring earned him notoriety, whether it was his Warrior comic book, his time as a motivational speaker, or his short-lived Warrior University. Each instance spotlighted an odd aspect of the Warrior's character, whether it was his seemingly homoerotic confrontation with Santa in the Warrior comic, his speech that queering doesn't work during a college appearance, or his unique take on philosophy. The Warrior was still considered someone capable of popping a crowd, so it's no surprise that TNA's Jeff Jarrett invited him to check out his new promotion. Now, that didn't work out, and the Warrior's only appearance in the 21st century is believed to be a match against Orlando Jordan at New Wrestling Evolution. In 2005, the WWE released its DVD, The Self-Destruction of the Ultimate Warrior, a documentary which consisted of various wrestlers and backstage individuals bad-mouthing the Warrior and throwing in a handful of matches. The one disc collection was highlighted by past and present superstars commenting on what a complete lunatic the Warrior was, as well as disparaging the quality of his matches. At one point, the WWE reached out to the Warrior for his comments, but to no one's surprise, the Ultimate Warrior turned down the WWE's request to appear on their show Bite This, responding, "I tried to tell you, Ultimate Warrior is bigger than our dislike for one another. You should have just let him be what he was. Oh, he still will be. His fans won't have it any other way. You are of course finding this out for yourself right now. But you, look what you've done to yourself. Similar to an exhibitionist sick to show the world their tiny shriveled private parts, you've done nothing but unclothe the canker sores of your wicked personality. Of course I do not accept this brainless, disgraceful invitation. F*** no, I do not. You can rescue yourself, Vince. Do your own damage control. I've no ear for your begging anymore. Only if you were on fire would I help you. It'd just be too hard to resist pissing on you." At this point, the Warrior's relationship with the WWE was so bad that some fans saw it as the exception to the rule that there are no such things as burnt bridges in the WWE. Wrestling legend has it that WWE's burial of the Warrior led to Bret Hart cooperating with the promotion when they compiled a DVD. Bret Hitman Hart, the best there is, the best there was, the best there ever will be, had he not, it was rumored to be titled Screwed, the Bret Hart story. Warrior sued the WWE, but the case went nowhere. One of the biggest questions concerning the Warrior's reconciliation with the WWE is whether he knew he was living on borrowed time. His father died young at the age of 52, and the Warrior predicted an early death for himself too. During a 1999 deposition for a court case involving the WWF, the Warrior testified, "I'm thinking about, you know, I just had my 37th birthday. I've got 20 years left in my life maybe. I mean, you know, I'm doing these calculations in my head. My grandfathers die at 52. In some cases, people are genetically disposed to die much earlier than others, and it seems the Warrior saw his father and grandfather's relatively young deaths as a reminder he was living on borrowed time. Awareness of one's mortality can lead to a radical shift in thinking, and it's been suggested this is what drove the Warrior's seemingly unlikely reconciliation with WWE. An often overlooked motive for the Warrior's return is that he was broke. After the Warrior's death, his brother Jay posted a message on Facebook claiming Dana Warrior was a gold digger and the Warrior returned to the WWE because he was broke and she was going to leave him, taking their kids. Here's an excerpt from the shocking accusation. "I know I talked to Jim a short time before his death and the impression I got was he was getting ready to be left by his wife and his kids because he was out of money. If people only knew what a fake person this lady is fake. I met her when she was 22, straight out of college. She turned her back on her own mother for money. I had nothing against her until I talked to Jim that last time they were at Disney World and they wouldn't even slow down, so we kept up walking with them. I'm not trying to convince people that Jim was any kind of saint. He was a self-controlling, self-centered narcissist, but he was my brother." Was the Warrior close to financial ruin? This would explain his complete 180 in patching things up with the WWE. The Warrior signed a contract with the WWE and was going to serve as an ambassador for the promotion. If you watched the WWE DVD Ultimate Warrior Always Believe, you remember it contains a number of encounters between the Warrior and WWE personnel, with heartwarming moments as the WWE legend reconnects with wrestlers from the past and present. As touching as it might be, the Warrior DVD almost seems like a promotional piece for how wonderful the WWE is and what a big happy family it is, something a cynic might view as the WWE buying off the Warrior's endorsement after years of criticizing the promotion. The Warrior's final promo is incredibly eerie when taken into context that he died the next day.
Every man's heart one day beats its final beat. And if what that man did in his life makes the blood pulse through the body of others, then his essence, his spirit, will be immortalized by the storytellers, by the loyalty. You are the legend makers of Ultimate Warrior. And the spirit of Ultimate Warrior will run forever!
TMZ had learned Warrior was walking down a hallway at the Gainey Suites Hotel in Scottsdale, Arizona, and headed towards his car with his wife when he stopped, clutched his chest, and went down. The Ultimate Warrior's death at age 54 shocked the world. According to the Chicago Tribune, an autopsy on the 54-year-old wrestler, whose given name was James Helwig, confirmed his cause of death was atherosclerotic/arteriosclerotic cardiovascular disease, according to the Maricopa County Office of the Medical Examiner. The Warrior's death was so abrupt that fans still can't help but wonder if his willingness to enter the Hall of Fame was based on foreboding of death or a mere coincidence. However, it should be noted that the Warrior's stance towards the WWE had softened by early 2013, over a year before his induction into the Hall of Fame and his death. There were a number of different stories that came out after the Warrior's appearance at WrestleMania weekend. While it was generally agreed that he was happy to be there, there were remarks about his physical appearance. Ultimate Warrior looked like he was on the verge of a medical catastrophe all weekend, sweaty and stressed, like he was about to burst at the seams, eyewitnesses tell TMZ. According to sources who were with the Warrior this past weekend, the WWE legend looked like he was in constant pain, sweaty and looked very uncomfortable, like he was choking on his tie. It was apparent to everyone something was seriously off. Another warning sign, when Warrior did his signature top rope shake after his big speech on Monday Night Raw, he looked weak, and people around him noticed. One wrestler recalled Warrior looked off. Sean Waltman remarked, "I got a sense he wasn't well. It was sad to me. He was kind of hunched over. He used to have great posture. You just had this sense that he wasn't well. But he was in great spirits. He came up to other wrestlers and gave them hugs." Watching the Ultimate Warrior's address to the fans on Raw, it's hard not to notice how weak he looked. While he still looked physically impressive, he moved around the ring slowly and seemed to have trouble talking. It's difficult to watch the promo with the benefit of hindsight and not think something was terribly wrong with the Warrior's health. The Warrior led a life that was bizarre on many levels, whether it was his in-ring persona or his public persona as the Warrior. Thus, it's difficult to figure out his motives behind his abrupt return to the WWE. Did he know his time was limited and he wanted to go out on his own terms? Was he broke as his brother claimed and looking for income despite his long-standing grudge against Vince McMahon? With Warrior's wife Dana Warrior working in the WWE now, it's unlikely we'll ever know the full story. Well, there you have it guys, the final days of the Ultimate Warrior. We hope you enjoyed the episode, and as always, please like the video if you did, comment down below, and share it to as many people as possible. Also, if you haven't subscribed, maybe think of doing so. The next episode will be the final days of Yokozuna. As always, follow us on Instagram and Twitter, and I'll see you next time with some more wrestling content.